Dear students, welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am V.N. Prabhakar, visiting faculty at the Archaeological Sciences Center in Indian Institute of Technology, Gandhinagar. Under the paper Pre and Proto-Historic Cultures of India, we are going to discuss the module on the river Saraswati, or the Saraswati River. At the end of this module, you will be able to understand the various geographic, archaeological and cultural identification theories that existing on the river Saraswati, and also the evolution of river Saraswati in relation to the Vedic, early Vedic and later Vedic literature, and maybe its probable connection with the Indus Valley civilization. So what is the problem, the vexing problem behind the river Saraswati? We will discuss one by one. The Rig Vedic literature, that is the earliest of the Sanskrit literature, it mentions about the Sapta Sindhva, that is the seven rivers, that is the land of the seven rivers watered by Indus and its tributaries, which have been identified by the scholarly consensus with the land where Indus flows in the west, and its five tributaries with Saraswati River in the eastern side of this entire river tributary system. The Saraswati is also described as of great waters, like it used to flow with very high volume of water, and whose impetuous flow, that is unbroken and swift moving, one of the fastest and unbroken movement of river water from the mountain to the sea. That is the uniqueness, that the river originated in the mountains, high mountains, and it ultimately drained into the sea. That is effectively described by the term Giribhya Asamudrat in the Rig Vedic literature. The Saraswati River also receives highest praise in the Rig Vedic literature, and it is one of the highly deified rivers, or one can say it is the only deified rivers in the Rig Vedic literature. She is described as the best of the mothers, best of the rivers and best of the goddesses. That has been very effectively described by the term Ambitame, Naditame, Devitame, Saraswati. So it has been given a very high status in the Rig Vedic literature. So among the various suktas, the Nadi Stuti Sukta, it is the most prominent, which describes the geographical location of the river Saraswati. So we have to understand the ancient geography also in terms of the land in which the river Saraswati watered. So in one of the verses, river Saraswati is praised, and it is location is told in relation to the other rivers, like it is described as O Ganga, Yamuna, Saraswati, Shutidri, like a series of rivers are mentioned, as though one person is mentioning the sequence of rivers from the east to west. That's how he starts with Ganga, then proceeds to Yamuna, Saraswati, Shutidri, that is identified with Satluj, Parushni, that is identified with Ravi. Then he mentions, the poet mentions all other rivers like Asikni, Marudvridra, Vitasta, and other rivers. So these are all a sequence of events, and if we try to place the river Saraswati, where do we place? We can definitely place the river Saraswati between Yamuna and Shatudri, that is Yamuna and Satluj, that is where its geographical location is. If we look into the map, it can be also very easily placed where this river is located. It is located between the Yamuna and the Satluj rivers, and flows parallel to the river Indus, almost parallel to the river Indus in the areas of Cholistan, modern day Cholistan and southern Sindh, and ultimately draining into the run of Kutch. That's how the geography of the river Saraswati can be understood. It can be very well understood, and it can be very well said from the verse also, what are the various sequence of rivers, and that's how it's a clear indication that Saraswati was located in this, within this geographical zone, and during the Rig Vedic period. There are various mention of these rivers. I mean, there are rivers named in the Greek literature also. Greek travelers who came along with Alexander the Great during his invasion, and there are certain English terminologies also. And if we kind of correlate with the Sanskrit names with the Greek and the English, there are equivalent, like Ganga, it is more or less mentioned with the same name, Gange or Ganges, and in English also it is Ganges. Like that, we find each and every reference of these rivers in the other languages also, and that is how we can also identify, like Asikni, that is Chinab, it is mentioned in the Greek literature as Akisines. So there are various mentioned in the literature, and gradually some of these rivers, they went on a transformation, and that is how Shutudri has become Satluj. So we can identify, we can trace back the original name of these rivers, identify them as per the geographical context, and also understand their importance in terms of development of cultures. So there are various maps and travelogues which also help us in identify, because now River Saraswati is a dried up river. There are no traces in many parts of the area in between Indus and Yamuna, but there are places where this river can be very easily identified. So if we travel back in time, we have several written accounts of travelogues or geographers who traversed this area and who have left an idea. There is one map datable to the 1760. It shows the river Saraswati as a tributary of Ghuggar or Ghaggar. So it has been spelt variously, but it is clearly mentioning that river Saraswati in its upper reaches, it is joining the river Ghaggar. So this can be understood from one of the earliest maps, even dating back to 18th century. So one more map, it is a detail of a map available from 1778. It is a map drawn by the Surveyor General of Bengal, which also mentions the river Ghaggar and Saraswati. You can see the red mark, red arrows. It clearly shows the location of this river. The Saraswati River is below, and it joins the Ghaggar River, which is flowing from the top. So even in the 18th century, people have identified the local legends. They clearly identify the flowing of this river, the existence of this river, maybe at least in the upper reaches. So what is the picture emerging from this? In the early 19th century, the topographical survey, that is the survey initiated by the British, it clearly mentions this river Saraswati based on the work by Lieutenant Colonel James Todd in the 1820s, then Major Colvin in 1833, and Major Mackensen in 1844. They have made some of the very valuable observations. They have observed that a very wide, dried bed called Ghaggar, dotted with ancient ruins. This is a most important aspect. Why ancient ruins should dot along the banks of a dried up river? And a local tradition according to which the drying of the river caused the region's desolation. So this is one another important aspect, like drying up of this river caused the local population to migrate to other regions, and the ruins were fell into disuse. The presence of fresh water wells along the Ghaggar's bed that could allow large bodies of troops. I mean, the troops can travel along the dry beds of the river, and with the existence of the wells along the dry bed, one can very easily utilize these wells, even if a large army can travel in this route. That is another major observation, because of the maybe ensuing capture of Sindh area by the British. Maybe that could be one of the objectives, and it was very well documented in these accounts. And also a seasonal river called Saraswati or Saraswati, it has been pronounced Saraswati. So it formed one among the Ghaggar's tributaries. So these were the four important observations made by the topographical surveys initiated by the early stages of the British occupation in India. So one of the French geographer, Louis Vivien de Saint-Martin, is the author of a book known as The Study on the Geography and the Primitive People of India's Northwest According to Vedic Hymns. So he is one of the earliest author, one can say, who tried to identify the Ghaggar system as a relic system of the Vedic Saraswati. That is one of the important observations that was made way back in 1860. He observes the trace of the ancient riverbed was recently found, still quite recognizable, and was followed far to the west. This discovery confirmed the correctness of the tradition. So he tried to kind of identify with the existing tradition of flowing of river Saraswati, and try to identify with the Vedic tradition. Another map datable to the 1862, it clearly shows the Saraswati and Ghaggar. So this is from the Henry Beveridge, A Complementary History of India's Civil, Military, Social and social history. So one can understand again the Saraswati is shown as a tributary. From the map, one can really understand in the upper reaches it was a distinctly flowing river, and it joins Ghaggar in the upper stream. So this is one of the continuing traditions. We have seen map of the 18th century and also in the 19th century the same picture emerges. One more map drawn by the founder of the Archaeological Survey of India, that is Alexander Cunningham, datable to 1871 from his Ancient Geography of India. Again, Saraswati is shown as a tributary of the river Ghaggar. So it is clearly indicative of the presence of the river in the upper reaches and joining the river Ghaggar slightly down below in the lower stream. So one more map datable to 1881 also shows Saraswati, that is from a book known as Indiae Vediki D 1800 by Marius Fontane. So this also identifies river Saraswati, and here one can see it joins the river Shutudri. It is not flowing independently, but it is joining Shutudri or Satluj. So this is a quite an erroneous observation, but still the existence of the river Saraswati is shown in this map along with the concept of the Sapta Sindhu. So one more work, Oldham, he was a surgeon and a major in the Indian Army. He made very good observations and he drew a map, and he observes that although the river below the confluence, which is the Ghaggar, is marked in a map as Ghaggar, it was formerly the Saraswati. So he makes another identification, or he again reiterates the identification of Ghaggar with river Saraswati, and which is still known among the people. He mentions that the name Saraswati is still known among the people and the tradition is still continuing. So in the later literature from the Brahmanas onwards, the Saraswati breaks up at a point known as Vinashana or Adarshana, regarded as the holy Tirtha in the later Brahmanical literature. The Mahabharata, it also describes the Saraswati as flowing westwards and getting lost. We trace a literary continuation, a period in which Saraswati was flowing. It was flowing from Giribhya a Samudrat, from the mountain to the seas. But in the later literature, it is mentioned as merging into the sand, and it is becoming Vinashana, or it is merging or dying into the desert. So the map drawn by French Indologist Jean Philizot shows the northwest in the Mahabharata age, that the northwestern part of the South Asia in the during the Mahabharata age, with the Drishadvati meeting the Saraswati upstream of the Vinashana. So here the tributary, one more tributary of Saraswati, that is Drishadvati, broadly identified with the modern Chautang river or Chatrang Nadi, as it is locally known as in Rajasthan. It means it meets Saraswati river just upstream of the Vinashana. So Vinashana can be identified downstream of this confluence of river Saraswati and Drishadvati, and then interestingly the confluence is just downstream of the ancient Harappan site of Kalibanga in Rajasthan. So this general survey, it shows that there is a consensus emerging among various geographers, various travelers, and also Indologists and geologists. And one may look into the literature and generally agree upon the kind of consensus emerging upon the scholarly world, how this dry bed of river Saraswati or a halfly flowing river Ghaggar can be identified with the river Saraswati of the Vedic tradition. And this has been proved from the archaeological literature, archaeological investigations also. The archaeological investigation starting very early from the early part of 20th century, starting from the times of Mark Aurelstein and going on up to even the later period, up to many archaeologists like Kenoyer, Posel or Bisht or D.K. Chakraborty, all these people try to understand this river in terms of the river Saraswati only. The maps drawn by this archaeologist in various publications also indicate that the river Saraswati can be identified with the combined river systems of Ghaggar and river Hakra, Ghaggar in India and Hakra in modern day Pakistan. Towards the end of the 20th century, we also got a very good tool, that is the remote sensing. The advancement of space research in India, it also helped us in identification of dried river beds. But this particular map, it is from the National Geographic, one can see a long flowing river, and the dry bed is clearly marking the entire desert area, and it is disappearing somewhere downstream, somewhere in the Cholistan, modern day Cholistan region. And the different river systems can be very easily identified, and in between Yamuna and Satluj we can see there are marked many streams emanating from the upper portion of the region down below the Shivaliks, and flowing south-southwestwards and joining, some are merging, and some are flowing independently and ultimately lost in the river. The very broad river system which flows south-southwestwards, it is the river Ghaggar, that is indicated by the red arrows in this map. So interestingly, if we plot ancient sites located in Rajasthan, Haryana, Cholistan and Sindh, particularly belonging to the 3rd millennium BC Harappan civilization or the Indus Valley sites, interestingly we notice a pattern. What is this pattern? This pattern is indicated by the location of these sites all along the dried river Ghaggar. So this is very interesting and indicating the existence of a once forgotten civilization all along this river Saraswati or river Ghaggar, and which is also indicative of the fact that the river was flowing, it was flowing in with full of waters, during which period these sites are located and this civilization was existing. The remote sensing also indicates various dried up channels, various paleo channels, and work carried out by ISRO, it clearly indicates various streams existing very much parallel to the river Indus and ultimately draining into the Run of Kutch. These are very clear indications, and we see a clear marked course towards the east of the river Indus, very wide floodplain, and some places it is 3 kilometers, some places it is 6 kilometers wide floodplain that has been flowing continuously from the upper reaches to the lower reaches, that is to the up to the Run of Kutch. So we understand from the modern topographical survey also what is the situation at present. We know there are various channels emanating from the Shivalik region between Satluj and River Yamuna. There are various streams variously known as Choya Nadi, Markanda Nadi, Saraswati River, Ghaggar River. All these things emerge in a fan like structure. There is a geological phenomena in which the rivers, due to the slowly upliftment and other geological features, they are fanning out. They are not flowing in one particular river stream. They are fanning out and flowing here and there, and ultimately some merge together and flow continuously. And when the monsoon is particularly very good, some of these streams join together and emanate into the Ghaggar River, which has a steady flow up to even Hanumangarh or even up to the Cholistan desert, and beyond that it becomes merged into the desert. As I told you earlier, some of the sites of the Indus civilization, there are more than 2500 sites, and if we plot these sites on a geo-coordinate system, these occur all along the Ghaggar River, Ghaggar Hakra River. And if you look into the map, one can clearly understand the location of a large number of sites in the upper stream as well as the lower stream. Particularly if we look into the Cholistan region, there are a concentration of large number of sites, and obviously one very huge site, Ganverivala, which is one among the 5 largest Harappan settlements. It is also located on the modern Hakra River, that is forming part of the ancient river Saraswati. And the Indus civilization was more than 1 million square kilometers watered by all these rivers, starting from Indus and its 5 tributaries, Saraswati and upper reaches of Yamuna during the later part. So mature Harappan sites are found in the river Saraswati basin. They were initially identified by the British explorer and the archaeologist Mark Arlstein. Mark Arlstein was a remarkable explorer. He explored this region even at the age of 78 years, and he is remarkable in exploring other regions also in Central Asia and Taklamakan area. And he identified many sites in the last river Saraswati region. And this survey, it was conducted around 1940-41, which was again followed by another major survey by the former Director General of Archaeological Survey of India, Amalananda Ghosh. He identified again some of the major sites identified by Mark Arlstein, and again he discovered many new sites also. And one of the most prominent sites revisited by Amalananda Ghosh was Kalibangan, which was later excavated by Archaeological Survey of India. So if we look into the survey of number of sites, like many different river systems supported Harappan sites. So if we plot all these sites in a tabulated format, we naturally found that the Saraswati river system supported a large number of sites. If you look into the mature Harappan sites of the Saraswati river system, it is around 360 sites. When compared to other regions, it is more or less equal or only slightly lesser than the Indus river system. So this was another major reason to believe that this river was in flow. Otherwise, how can it sustain or support such a large number of settlements? So this is one remarkable point that has to be taken into notice when we understand the overall existence of sites during the Indus civilization between the 2600 BCE and 1900 BCE. So as I explained previously, many of the archaeologists also, they have identified this river, that is the modern day Ghaggar and Hakra, with the ancient Saraswati. And the maps published by these scholars also, they clearly show this river in the upper reaches and again joining the river Ghaggar, that is modern, and ultimately river Hakra in the Pakistan area. So all these river systems combined together could have been the river Saraswati system with the combined tributaries during the 3rd millennium BCE. Now we move to some of the important sites which are located on this ancient river system and try to identify their location, their kind of orientation, how they are placed in relation to the ancient river. We take the example of Banavali. If you look into the plan of the Banavali that was excavated by R.S. Bisht, former Joint Director General of Archaeological Survey of India, the Acropolis or the Citadel Mound, it is facing the dry bed of the river Saraswati. Now it is facing the dry bed of river Saraswati. So it has some relation, it is more or less parallel to the flow of the river. And it is clear indicating of also one of the gates adjacent to the Acropolis, it also leads to the river. If we take the account of another site, that is Kalibanga, which is located downstream of Banavali. So it is a three mound system, two mounds fortified, and the gates on the northern side, it leads to the river Saraswati or the river Ghaggar. So it is also one of the important aspects taken into consideration, why it is facing, why the entrances are leading towards the river, so that they can have access, the inhabitants, they can have access to the river which is flowing nearby, so that they can avail of the water resources very close to their settlement for various purposes. So now we come to another aspect of what could be the decline of urban order of the Indus Valley civilization, and in any way is it related to the also drying up of river Saraswati. There are various theories put forth by the scholars why this flourishing civilization for nearly 700 years came to an end around 1900 BCE. Some of the scholars, they put forth an idea of invasions, but now it has been completely discounted, because earlier some of the scholars based on the evidence from Mohenjo-daro, they suggested an invasion, but now it has been completely discarded. Is there a reason for geographical overstretch? It could be one of the reasons. I mean, how Harappans, they were expanding, and it could have drained their resources to a certain level. There could be an economic decline also, because they were having a very vivid and dynamic internal trade as well as an external trade. Maybe at some point of time the trade mechanism could have snapped, and that could have led to the decline. Another reason could be a great drought from 2200 BCE, the climatic data which is available recently, that is also another indicative, and we can discuss it later in a more detailed manner, but that could be one of the reasons. And ultimately, that could be the reason for the drying up of the river Saraswati. There could be one more reason of the overuse of resources. We have known of the Harappans using resources from various regions, from south, east, west, wherever they can get best of the resources. And these resources completely, they were helping in the economic boom of this Harappan civilization. At one point of time, these resources, that approach to the resource could have been snapped, and also they could have overstretched whatever available, and that could have also led to the decline. But all these factors combined together could have formed a part or formed a role in the decline of the urban order. And ultimately, drying up the river Saraswati, this could be one aspect that should have been that could be understood looking into the various factors, and it is also now accepted as one of the major causes looking into the settlement pattern. If you look into the settlement pattern of the Harappan phase, early Harappan phase and later Harappan phase, and the location of the settlements all along the river, so we clearly understand that after 1900 BCE, the settlements located all along the Saraswati River, they have shifted towards the east, either towards the east or towards the south, wherever the water sources are available. This settlement pattern is a clear indication, because from the early Harappan to the mature Harappan phase, we find settlements all along the Saraswati River, and during the late Harappan phase, that is after the 1900 BCE, the settlements in the Cholistan region, Rajasthan region, they are gradually abandoned, and they are shifting towards the east, towards the upper reaches of this river, where the water still could have flowed up to a certain distance. And we see a large number of settlements in the Haryana region, western UP region. So these Harappans were moving away from their original homeland and settling in new settlements, and also abandoning their urban centers, maybe for want of water resources. We see a dramatic increase in the number of settlements during the late Harappan phase. The settlements are new, but they are very small when compared to the urban centers of the Harappan phase, that is from 2600 to 1900 BC. This is another indication of localization of the Harappan civilization, how the urban centers are abandoned and more centers are established away from their original homeland, and again where the water sources are available, and more towards the upper reaches. That is where the water was still available, in the upper reaches of the dried up river Saraswati. Some of the recent geological studies, it has also helped in confirming the abandonment of the central portion of the river Saraswati basin around 1900 BCE. So if we look these kind of studies, it clearly shows the abandonment of the river, that is due to the non-availability of water in the upper reaches. Maybe one of the reasons put forth by the scholars is that river Satluj, which was joining river Saraswati, it also shifted its course, and it was captured by the main Indus system, and that's how the major water flow, which is a glacier fed, that is river Satluj, a glacier fed river joining river Saraswati and contributing a large water flow, it went to the river Indus system. So that could also be one of the reasons. What could be the nature of river Saraswati, whether it was a perennial river, or it's a glacier fed river, or it is only a monsoon fed river? If we look into the various studies conducted by the scholars, I mean, we kind of try to understand, like some of the scholars, they say that the lack of large scale incision on the river, rivers Yamuna and Satluj, interflow, that is the in between region between Yamuna and Satluj, it demonstrates that large glacier fed rivers did not flow across the Ghaggar Hakra region. So the clear indication of the surface topography, it indicates that there was no large glacier fed river flowing in between the Yamuna and the Satluj river system. So the reliable monsoon rains were able to sustain a perennial river earlier during the Holocene. Holocene started around 12,000 BCE and explains why Harappan settlements flourished along the entire Ghaggar Hakra system without access to a glacier fed river system. So the monsoon, the weakening of the monsoon could be one of the reasons, and it weakened and the monsoonal rivers gradually dried or became seasonal and affecting the habitability along their courses. Some of the geologists like Puri, Verma or Valdia, they have disagreed with this kind of argument, and they argued in favor of a glacial contribution to the Saraswati system. But even if the Saraswati did not have the glacier sources, it could still have been a perennial river because of the good monsoon, and ultimately it started to dry up when the monsoon weakened, and other reasons like the tectonics and earthquakes, they could have played a major role in the ultimate breaking up of this river. There are various paleo environmental studies they are also conducted, and these, what these paleo environmental studies they indicate an abrupt shift in the monsoon worldwide. It's a worldwide phenomena starting from around 2200 BC. It started to emerge around 2200 BC, and gradually it worked and resulted in a decline in the total volume of the monsoon precipitation. So it is not a sudden event. It started in 2200 BC and gradually it weakened the monsoon precipitation, and it could have been the one of the reasons in the loss of the river Saraswati, and it could have led to the change in agricultural patterns, because the Harappans all along they have been practicing a set pattern of agricultural practices that has been now changed because of change in monsoonal patterns, because change in river water resources availability. So ultimately that could also be one of the reasons. So the monsoon, the change in the monsoon, the weakening of the monsoon feeding the river Saraswati, that could be one of the reasons of decline the Harappan civilization in this portion between the river Satluj and Yamuna. There are other aspects, the other sources also in studying the paleoclimate. One such study is the oxygen isotope analysis, because the oxygen isotope analysis, they are clear indications of the past climatic conditions, how the climate prevailed during a particular point of time. One such study, which was conducted very recently and published in February 2014, on the ratios of oxygen isotopes in gastropods. Gastropods are the snails that the riverine or the lacustrine, snails which are bred locally in a paleo lake, from the sediments of a paleo lake, Kotla Dahar in Haryana. It also points out a similar evidence that the weakening of the Indian summer monsoon, it happened around 4100 years ago. So this is another important study. There are various paleoclimatic studies and paleoenvironmental studies. All these studies, if they are converged together and if they are indicating a similar result, then we can accept all these things, and we can definitely understand there was a weakening of monsoon towards the end of the third millennium BC. So there are burial channel systems also in Haryana. Like if we look into the various buried river channels and understand the pattern of these things, we identify there are younger fluvial activity in a limited area and in the Haryana region, which are datable to various radiometric techniques between 6,000 years ago to 2,900 years ago, that is 2,900 years ago. This again includes the Harappan region. This time frame, it falls within the Harappan period. So this is the kind of picture emerging. There was a flowing of the river identified through various sources, and weakening of monsoon and the flowing of the river coincides with the existence of the Harappan civilization. And a more recent study by one of the geologists from IIT Kanpur on the subsurface stratigraphy of the Ghaggar and Paleo Satluj Valley through electrical resistivity methodology, this also indicates the evidence of a Paleo river flowing in this region. Again, the dating of this Paleo river helps in understanding its flowing once upon a time. So the geologists, they have utilized a technique known as electricity resistivity method here in understanding the ancient channels, buried channels of the Satluj and Ghaggar. And through this electricity resistivity soundings, they were mapping a large scale geometry and architecture of the paleo channel system. They were able to plot this paleo channel system, and they could understand that a thick and extensive sand body is present in the subsurface in parts of northwestern Rajasthan, Haryana and Punjab. So this is a clear stratigraphical evidence, because all the while we are looking into the buried channels from the satellite imageries, from the topographical surveys and all those things, and the monsoon river feeds. But now there is a scientific technique available in mapping a buried river channel and buried sand deposits that is emanated from a flowing of the river. Because we are not talking about any flowing of underground river, we are talking about the deposit that was due to a flowing river once upon a time, that is the sand deposit which is existing in the subsurface alluvium in the Ghaggar Valley. So this is an important point. that also supported by the existence of major sites along this paleo channel, that is Kalibangan is one such site, Kunal is one such site. So these are located very close to the subsurface channel body. So this suggests that maybe a special relationship between the Gagar Hakra paleo channel and the Harappan site distribution that has been concluded by Rajiv Sinha of IIT Kanpur. So coming to the conclusion, throughout the module we have been discussing about the various aspects of River Saraswati, its the tradition, its association in the early Vedic literature, later Vedic literature, and also in the epic period, how during the Mahabharata period it has been described as a Vinashana and it is last in the desert. So all this kind of varying degrees of importance of the river we have been discussing. So initially it was described as a goddess of intuition in the Rig Veda. She was the goddess of speech in the Yajur Veda, that is the later Vedic literature. Later, Saraswati has been identified as the goddess of knowledge and arts, with some of her attributes transferred to Ganga. So there is a change in the perception, change in the understanding, because of the once flowing river, later half flowing river, maybe during only the some of the monsoon becoming very active in good years, and again completely drying up of the river and only evidence in certain pockets only. So the importance of this river is also transferred to the kind of worship on the form of the goddess itself, and it is reflected in the continuing periodization or continuing literary aspects, and we can see this gradual transformation. And another important aspect is that the Indus Valley civilization left a considerable technological and cultural legacy for the Ganges or the Gangetic civilization, because all along the civilization was in existence in the Indus Valleys and the adjoining Gagar Hakra river valleys, but it also contributed to a larger extent for the later civilization which emerged in the Gangetic civilization. The Saraswati river, which disappeared, had led some of the late Harappan sites or late Harappans, they migrated towards the east and occupied the Ganga Yamuna Doab during the post 1900 BCE, 1800 BCE, and actually these sites or these habitations are the linkages between the Harappan civilization or the Indus Valley civilization and the later civilizations which emerged more or less at the same time in the Gangetic plain or the upper Gangetic plain. So we have tried to trace this river through various manifestations and the probable correlation with the once flourishing civilization because of the location of large number of sites along its river banks and ultimately towards its end, which is also coinciding with the falling of one of the ancient civilizations. I hope this module will help in understanding this river. Now it is completely lost and only dried beds are available in many parts of Haryana, Rajasthan and in parts of Pakistan, and you will be interested to knowing further. You can explore the other modules, you can log into the EPG Pathshala website and try to explore other aspects related to the Indus Valley civilization and pre and proto-historic cultures of India.